Welcome to Great News for the World. If you've traveled much in this world, you've probably been impressed with the number of monuments, the number of plaques, the great buildings that men have erected to remember the events that have been significant in history. Oh, there is the great Ishtar Gates of ancient Babylon still around. There is the very great image that Constantine built in Rome to commemorate his victories. It's significant that wherever you record man's history, you see how he's trying to emphasize these things about his life. There's another record of human history. This record of human history is in God's Word. And it's amazing how different it is. My name is Frank Abel. My guest is Mr. Colin Badger. Together, we'd like to tell you about it. In the prophecy of Habakkuk, chapter 2, verse 14, the Bible states, "For the earth shall be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord as the waters cover the sea." Now, that's never happened. Even though, of course, mankind have been around for a long time, we've never yet seen a period in man's history that we could say that the earth is filled with the glory of God. Look, while there's monuments like we see around this earth, it's to the glory of man. We don't yet see the earth filled with God's glory. To have the earth filled with God's glory, we would have to have not great monuments signifying the battles of history, but we would have to have a population of people who have as their greatest ideal to be like the example that God gave to mankind of character, the Lord Jesus Christ. And the earth would be filled with honesty. It would be filled with peace. It would be filled with joy and with hope, quite different than what we now see it, and quite different from maybe the expectations of a lot of people. There is another Bible passage I'd like you to have a look at, because this one tells us that God created the earth with a purpose. The prophet Isaiah, chapter 45, verse 18, tells us this. And in that passage we read, "For thus saith the Lord that created the heavens, God himself that formed the earth and made it, he hath established it, he created it not in vain, he formed it to be inhabited. I am the Lord, there is none else." Now that is what God is telling us is his purpose with the earth. So while we see the earth filled with the monuments of men, indicating that that's the way they really see history and how as they see it to be significant, there has to be a great change. But I think one of the most interesting things that we can show you is to look at God's Word as it sees man's history. You know, God's Word is worth looking at, because when you consider the historical aspects of God's Word, do you know it's without fault? With all the digging that men have done in and under the general name of archaeology to try to see what ancient civilizations were like, they have only confirmed the biblical record. The Bible's history is very correct and very exact, and it's certainly worth looking at from the point of view as what did God see to be the significant parts of man's history? Well, Colin, maybe you can tell us.
The history of mankind, as recorded in the Bible, is God's perspective of what he considers to be the major events in the earth's history. The Bible begins its history of mankind in the book of Genesis. Now, the word Genesis means the beginnings. And what does it begin with? The Genesis account begins with the creation of the first man, Adam, as illustrated for us on our time chart. We see there that Adam was created about 4000 B.C. The Bible presents Adam and his wife as the progenitors of the human race. The consequence of Adam's disobedience is summarized for us in the New Testament by the Apostle Paul. "By one man," says Paul in the letter to the Romans, "by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin. And so death passed upon all men." In his epistle to the Corinthians, Paul writes, "As in Adam all die, so in Christ shall all be made alive." following the period of Adam, we come to a very important character in the Bible, Lamech. Lamech is the father of Noah. Before Noah was born, Lamech had a son named Jubal. We are told in the Genesis account that Jubal was the father of all such as played the organ and the harp. There's a hint here in the Genesis record that the society that Adam lived in was actually more sophisticated than some historians would have us believe. We come then to the next most important character, to Noah. And with Noah, we find an outstanding example of a man who had faith and obedience in his work for God, particularly as we see him constructing the ark against all the hackling and the jackling that went on around him at that time. The flood's destruction of the world illustrates God's dissatisfaction with the wickedness of mankind and God's ability to destroy an ungodly world. Following our time chart, about 2000 BC, we come to the time of God's judgments against the Tower of Babel. At this time we see then, according to the biblical account, the division of the races by their different languages. A few hundred years later, the Genesis record introduces us to a man called Abraham, father of the faithful, as he is sometimes called. And the Bible record tells us that Abraham received a number of very important promises. In fact, in the New Testament, Paul tells us that the gospel was preached to Abraham. Paul tells us in the letter to the Galatians that if ye be Christ's, then are ye Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. The Bible then introduces us to the man Jacob, the grandson of Abraham, father of the 12 tribes of Israel, who, with Joseph's assistance, brings the Israelites down into Egypt. And then we come to Moses, perhaps a better known character in the Bible. Moses leads the Hebrews through the Red Sea into the wilderness. And in the wilderness he receives God's commandments and delivers them to Israel. He then forms, through God's commandments, the nation of Israel. Taking over from Moses, Joshua led the Israelites into the promised land and divided up the various territories in the land of Israel, giving the territories to the respective tribes. Then we come to Saul, the first king of Israel. This is the beginning of the monarchy of Israel. And Saul's successor, David, we find another very important biblical character who's given very important promises. Now, David was on the throne at about 1000 BC. And these promises given to David have a great deal of effect in terms of how we understand Messiah's work. In fact, in the Gospel of Luke, in the account that explains what was said to Mary when Jesus Christ was born, we read from the speech of the angel, "He shall be great. He shall be the Son of the Highest. The Lord God shall give unto him," Jesus, "the throne of his father David." And later on in the New Testament, the Apostle Paul, in writing to the Romans, in his introductory chapter, makes the point that Jesus was of the seed of David. The promises that were given to David then pertained to the coming Messiah and to his kingdom that would be established on the earth after the pattern of David's own kingdom. Shortly after David's reign, the nation of Israel becomes divided. 10 tribes are polarized in the north from the 2 southern tribes of Judah and Benjamin, Judah becoming the most prominent in the south. We then move on to a man called Hoshea. In the 7th century BC, Hoshea was the last king of the northern 10 tribes. These tribes were finally taken captive due to their disobedience by the Assyrian invasion that came down and took them away in the 7th century BC. Another 100 years passes, and again we find an invasion from the north. This time, the Babylonians, led by Nebuchadnezzar, come down and take the remaining 2 tribes in the south into captivity. We then end this portion with the last monarch of Israel, Zedekiah, who is taken into captivity with his people, and there he is destroyed. Frank?
Thank you, Colin. Well, there's an example of how God looks at history. And I'm sure that taking, as Colin did, the time span over which there was between Adam and Zedekiah, there's a lot of events that took place there that are not recorded in man's view of history. It didn't mention the great kingdom of Babylon, although it is in God's word. It didn't mention the great kingdom of Assyria. It didn't mention the other things of which we only know now about on the basis of archaeology. But it did mention certain biblical or certain people that in the Bible are paramount of importance. Now, where is the record today of Adam? Where could we go on earth today to try to learn about Adam? Or to ever know that there was a man Adam? Or that the beginning of the human race started with Adam? Well, you know, it is significant. God is not left without witness concerning this. I don't intend to go through the time it would take to show you the example, but there is a mathematical process by which we can go back in time on the basis on which the population is increasing to see just how long ago it would have been that there could have been two people to account for the population present. You know, Adam fits in there real well. We started off by saying it was about 6,000 years ago, and that's just about as far as you can take it back if you go at the rate of the population increase of, say, the Jewish people. God's not without witness concerning Adam. How about Noah? Where's the monument to Noah today? Except, my friend, that if you dig in the ground almost anywhere on this earth, you will find the evidence of a great flood. Why is it that we find the evidence of animals in the permafrost in northern climates that could not possibly live there now? It's an indication that there has been a great change on the earth. And that's exactly, of course, what God tells us about Noah's time. There was a great climatic change that took place, and the whole earth was covered with water. Well, you know, that's not all of it. We could go on. For instance, the man Abraham is not without witness because there's the whole race of people called after him, he being the first Jew. And now look, we have a Jewish race. So God's not without his witness. But then again, a very valid question, I think, for a person who follows the biblical record to answer is, why did God only choose to record Israel and Judah? As Colin has went through the kings of Israel and Judah, well, why didn't he go through the kings of Babylon? Why didn't he show us the kings of Assyria? Why didn't he show us the start of the ancient Chinese people? There's a good reason. God says that he has known only one people in all the earth, that is the people of Israel. And God has chosen to only record in the Bible record the things which involve the people of Israel. It's not that God the historian did not know about this, but God has showed us through the writers that he chose to write the Bible that what he wrote was written for our admonition, that we might look at these things that are written and learn from them. So they're only chosen on the basis of them being good enough to record for history, that men might learn from them. So obviously a lot of things are left out, but all the more importance to what is there. It's written so that there is no wasting of words when we think of the way God recorded history. So Colin, maybe we continue with the history of Israel and Judah.
Continuing with the history that we have seen it, going through the nation of Israel, following them down through the history as it's recorded in the Bible, we last dealt with the invasion of the Babylonians, sweeping down into Israel and taking the southern two tribes into captivity. Now their captivity lasted about 70 years. And then a man named Zerubbabel brought a small group of Jews back into the land of Israel. Now this occurred in about the latter half of the 5th century BC, as it's indicated in our time chart. Shortly after the time of Zerubbabel, another man, Nehemiah, brought another group of Jews back to the land of Israel to rebuild the walls of Jerusalem. Now, from the time of Nehemiah to the appearance of Jesus Christ on the earth, we advance some 400 years on our time chart. In other words, it is from the time of Malachi, the last book of the Old Testament, to the first book of the New Testament, the Gospel of Matthew. 400 years pass by. Nothing is recorded in the Bible about those 400 years. We come then to the appearance of Jesus Christ on the earth. In God's view of history, the birth of Jesus Christ marks the greatest event of all time. In the Gospels, Jesus is identified as the anointed Savior. Born of the Virgin Mary by the operation of the Holy Spirit, he was the only begotten Son of God. During his ministry, he revealed the character and the purpose of God. He demonstrated for all mankind the quality of life that God wishes all men to display. By his sinless life, Jesus demonstrated what God was like in character and person. By the crucifixion of Jesus, we come to understand that man is justly related to death and is therefore in need of salvation through faith in Christ's sacrifice. By his resurrection, we have an assurance that death has been conquered and that by faithfulness to him, we too will have the opportunity of receiving eternal life. The work of the apostles, the apostolic period, is a very important one that follows the work of Jesus Christ. They pick up, really, where Jesus Christ leaves off. The work of the apostles is really, in a sense, an extension of Messiah's work. What was their job? It was to organize the disciples of Christ into a vibrant community. Not only so, but also to enlarge their understanding of Christ's work. We come then to what could be called the emergence of the apostasy. Now, the word apostasy means a departure or a falling away. And in this context, when we talk about the emergence of the apostasy, we are talking about the rise of a departure from Christ's original teaching. And this period of apostasy really stretches from the apostolic period down through the ages until the return of Jesus Christ. Now, speaking of this period of apostasy or departure from truth, the Apostle Paul told the believers in Thessalonica, "Let no man deceive you," he said, "for that day," meaning the day of Christ, "shall not come except there come a falling away first." In fact, the word falling away there in the English really is the word apostasy. Unless that comes first, Christ would not return. So it's a very important concern as we look at Bible history. Reference to our time chart will indicate that in the year 70 AD, the Roman ruler Titus came down and destroyed the nation of Israel. In so doing, he took Jerusalem, he destroyed it, knocked down the walls, and scattered the Jewish people to the four corners of the Roman Empire. And thus began a long period of what could be called the dispersion, or the diaspora, during which time the Jews were persecuted and hounded from country to country, down through the years. We advance then from this period, from 70 AD, some 1800 years on our time chart, to the time of the Balfour Declaration in 1917, a British mandate that gave permission to the Jewish people to return to their homeland, to settle there, and to begin to establish their own nation once again. We believe that this is a very important event marking the closeness of Christ's return.
Yes, it certainly is, Colin. It's too bad in one sense, though, that the Balfour Declaration is not known as well as it ought to be, and how significant this was and the things that have happened. For I think most people appreciate that in the last 50 years, what's happened in man's history has been phenomenal. Well, look at the things that have happened in the era of science. Well, the tremendous scientific breakthroughs in their understanding of the world in which we live that have given rise to such things as taking a flight to the moon, being able to go out in outer space, and relying on the laws, of course, which are there. But being able to know more about the human body has given rise to operations that were never even thought of, ever imagined before. And as a result, people have come to think that, well, you know, man is not too bad. He's really coming up in the world in what he's doing. It's brought, however, with it, I think, a very false basis for looking at the future, because when people see other people doing things which they couldn't themselves ever imagine possible, they start to think, well, you know, maybe man can do anything. And maybe all the problems that man faces are now going to be solved because of the great breakthroughs that men are finally coming through with in the scientific circles. Well, I'd like to show you a little chart which might summarize that. Because on this chart, we can show you man's view of his own respectability. And in the last 50 years, well, at least say the ones from 1900 to 1950, and then, of course, going on in time, we see that man's respectability is greatly increasing. Man can do anything. On the other hand, when we look at the way God views these things, then we see an entirely different point of view. When we look at respectability of man from God's point of view in the last, say, 50 years, instead of seeing man's respectability increasing, it's decreasing at the same kind of a curve, the same kind of a rate. Now, why is it decreasing? What is it that God sees about man that is less respectable? Well, if you compare what's happened to men morally over the last, say, 50 years, maybe even less than that, then you can see from God's point of view why he thinks that man's, so to speak, is going down the drain. Because God is, as Colin has showed to us in history, has set out Jesus Christ as the example by which we're all measured. And there we saw morally perfection. We saw the man Jesus Christ morally perfect. And we see ourselves measured with that. Well, what is man doing now? Violence, and preparing for more violence. What's man doing morally? Well, if there's any cause for alarm, and the area is pollution in this world, we should be really alarmed with the mind pollution that's going on. Why is it that our children have to grow up in an environment which is so filled with the filth of man's imagination? God judged the people of Noah's day for this very reason. The earth was full of violence and it was corrupt, and man's thinking was entirely evil. Well, God's view of man's respectability is going down like that, and God's about to intervene because of it. And so we look at the future. We don't necessarily see such a tremendous picture immediately for mankind because of this problem that's so current in the world. But in relationship to our topic, we see something very special. We're not left in the dark, my friend, as to what the future holds. The future is pre-recorded by God, and that, of course, is something quite different than any of the historians that men have had. So, Colin, let's have a little inkling about the future.
In dealing with our last segment of Bible history, we are really looking at events as they relate to God's plan in the modern period. We've already referred to the British Mandate in 1917, the Balfour Declaration, that gave the Jews sanction to go back and establish themselves in the ancient land of their fathers, into the land of Israel. Now, the culmination of this movement, this return back to their land, really came in 1948, when the United Nations recognize the independent state of Israel. The return of the Jewish people to their homeland is a subject that has a great deal of interest for the students of Scripture. From prophecies like Jeremiah and Ezekiel, we have a very clear understanding that in God's foreknowledge, the Jewish people would be scattered throughout the world, would be persecuted and hated, but finally they would be regathered, and that the regathering into their land, this momentous event, would herald the appearance of their Messiah. We refer you to passages like Jeremiah 30 and 31, Ezekiel 36 and 37, that describe this scattering and this restoration for you. The Bible also affirms that when the Jewish people would be returning to their land and settling themselves, a great northern power would arise, which would gather together a confederation to invade Israel. Now, from the details that are given to us in Ezekiel 38 and 39, there is good reason to believe that this power in the north, to the very north of Israel, as the words of Ezekiel express it, this power would be modern-day Russia. And that this indication for us is clear in the Middle East today as we look at Russia's ambitions in the Middle East, indicating for us the details of Bible prophecy coming to their fulfillment. We go just a little bit further into the modern era. The scriptures indicate that this invasion from the north on the land of Israel would have the culmination in a great battle called Armageddon, that this battle would eventuate into a world war. But before it became a world holocaust, Christ would return. We look at the chart now, rather quickly, to see some of the details subsequent to Christ's return. He needs to resurrect his faithful. He needs to resurrect those who will also be responsible to him and proven to be unrighteous. The judgment will then take place. The Battle of Armageddon, as we've already referred to, will culminate by bringing the world's attention to the appearance of Christ on the earth. The world will submit to Christ, and Christ will establish his government over all the world. Then we will have the 1,000-year reign of Christ on the earth with his faithful educating the world at large. There will be a second resurrection and a second judgment of those who have been mortal in the kingdom. Finally, death itself will be ended. And the scriptures tell us that God will then be all in all.
Thank you, Colin. Right? It's really quite a beautiful picture of the future. And we hope we've certainly influenced you somewhat to investigate further as to what the Bible can tell you about the future. Because the Bible's got a lot to offer. Colin obviously didn't have enough time to go into the details of why we know that Russia will rise and will influence greatly the Middle East. He didn't go into some of the details about the great kingdom to come. It's there in God's Word. There it's pre-recorded because God alone has the knowledge, the foreknowledge of what's going to happen to tell us before the effect of the way it will be. That's one of the great differences between man's history and God's viewpoint of the same history. And not only that, but as we have seen down through the record of man's history, how he has tried to put monuments, he's tried to make great cities and build. Thank you.